Now, we record the video that Elizabeth then posts up on a website or what have you. I think they do some editing to it. I just start that recording. We do record the audio, obviously, for replay. That will be replayed tonight. It'll be replayed on Sunday at 11 a.m. And Monday morning, I'm trying to say, at midnight. Monday morning at midnight.
Oh, okay. So tonight you have a game?
Yes. And I've got the pieces of music. I've actually got them strung out. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to play it low underneath, but then of course we'll be going in and out of the program with the selections as well.
Okay. But can you do why don't we pick the Haydn? Can you do like one section, like somewhere in one of the four segments to do kind of a longer clip?
Every time it rains.
I can do, if you want me to play the Haydn piece, I can pull that up. Sure.
Okay.
All right, here we go. In 3, 2, 1, you're live.
Hello, 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 Santa Barbara. It's your chantress of everything valuable and beautiful, Elizabeth Stewart. And I am here with the Aeolus String Quartet. They are coming to Santa Barbara on the 17th, performing at the Santa Barbara Museum of Art. And I asked the director of the museum if I could speak to the four of them, because I love chamber music. They were kind enough to send me some pieces that they may or may not be performing, but we're going to be using their music throughout the interview today. And I want to first introduce, well, I have a question for Nicholas, but this is Nicholas Tavini. And I want to know, Nicholas, what a qualifying dynamic pitch adjustment decision structure in string.
That is the unfortunate title of my doctoral thesis.
And do you know the definition of the word? And we'll come up with a word. No, go right ahead, please.
Yeah, so what a qualifying dynamic pitch adjustment decision structure.
So it was quantifying dynamic pitch adjustment structures. It was my thesis was about trying to detect and quantify how string quartets adjust their pitch to one another, or in other words, like how we play in tune or not play in tune. Because they're always, actually the process of playing in a string quartet is one of continuous adjustment, and it's a very dynamic, active thing. It's not where you just kind of like push a button, you program in and it goes. So I basically, I recorded several different string quartets at different levels of experience. And then did a lot of analysis and math on the pitch contours to look at the pattern, the adjustment patterns.
Okay, so now this is a dumb question, but are you doing this by ear? Or are you doing this by some sort of a sound registration machine?
So
when you're because the first word in the doctoral thesis is quantifying.
That's right. Yeah, so obviously when we're playing, we're doing it all by ear, and that's the best. Like that's why we rehearse so much. It takes a long time to build up a kind of shared group understanding of pitch, and each group's understanding of that is unique, which is also what I was investigating. Like when we say like, oh, the Guarneri Quartet has this specific sound, or the Cleveland Quartet has a sound. Like, what does that mean actually? But what I did, as musicians, we look at it from the intuitive listening side. I was looking at it from a mathematical side. So I was using computer programs to quantify the pitch actually as a number over time, a time series, and then look at it that way.
And Richard, lest you think he's not qualified to do that, Nicholas also studied mathematical physics at Case Western Reserve.
I want to see his degree. I want to see his degree. No. and to that end, there is an element there that comes to mind. In a vocal quartet, which I was a part of, when you hit the chord between the four of you just right, you can hear this almost ringing sound along with the chord. Yes. That's how you know you've hit it. How do you know that the four of you have hit the right pitch. Let's just say if you're performing and the four of you have combined, if you will, perfectly.
Yeah, you're exactly right, Richard. It's basically the same. And we actually talk about singing a lot in our rehearsals. And actually, so we're listening for that ring. Part of what that means is that all of the overtones of your sound are kind of aligning, as well as just the fundamentals, because our sound is multidimensional. We have, like, it goes up kind of infinitely in terms of the overtone series. So we talk a lot about, like, having our overtones rub together and listen for that kind of magical ringing sound. And actually, it's interesting, there's not a lot of prior research on this, but the research that did exist was mostly on vocal groups, like what you're saying, and how they adjust to one another. So I think it's very similar.
That is amazing. And I just wanted to continue my introduction of Nicholas. I mean, the bio is so incredible. I picked a few things I thought were fantastic. First violinist in the Aeolus Quartet that we're interviewing all four today. Artist in residence at the Musica Viva New York, the quartet is, of course, but he's also concertmaster of the New Orchestra of Washington and a member of the Mark Morris Dance Group Music Ensemble. Richard knows my background is in ballet, and I know Mark Morris, and that's got to be a challenge. I know what dancers are like.
It's interesting.
And also the Smithsonian Chamber Players. Not only that, he's an educator, serves on the faculties of George Washington University School of Music, Point Counterpoint Music Festival, Masterworks Festival, University of Maryland High School Music Academy, teaching assistant to Juilliard Quartet at the Juilliard School. By the way, he studied at Juilliard. And of course, the quartet was a graduate quartet in residence 2013 to 2015. It's interesting, Nicholas, because my mom, and I want to tell you a little bit about my mom here, because she's 95. Wow. She was a lifelong concert pianist. And she has, you can only imagine when she was working her way through college, she actually attended Juilliard. She was the first female in conducting.
Wow, that's amazing.
Yeah, and she went on to conduct, Richard, by the way, female barbershop quartets.
Oh, cool.
Nice.
Right. So she conducted, when I was growing up, Sweet Adelines and Melodiers and, these female quartets. And I can remember, being in the little house in Illinois and having, my mom coach them through that sound that you're talking about, Nicholas, that, that purity of sound, that overtone and undertone that you were describing. I remember it well. I want to go on and introduce Rachel Shapiro. She's second violinist, based in Brooklyn. Well, all the Aeolus gang is based in New York City. She's the founding member and second violinist of the quartet. And she's an adjunct professor of violin at Montclair State University. She's professorial lecturer at the George Washington University, guest teaching artist at Brooklyn High School of the Arts. And she's been on a lot of summer conferences and programs, Bennington Chamber Music Conference, Texas Christian University College of Fine Arts Intensive Quartet Workshop. She's recorded for Naxos and Ezeka record label and currently on a label, The National. She also is a Juilliard graduate. She holds the artist diploma from Juilliard and a Doctor of Musical Arts from the University of Maryland, Master of Music from University of Texas at Austin, and Bachelor of Music from Cleveland Institute of Music. She also is a writer, and her work, I took a little quick look, her work is published in Strings Magazine, and she performs on a really special violin. And Rachel, can you tell us a little bit about the violin?
Oh, yes, I'd love to. So actually, the quartet is so fortunate that we met a very generous organization that has provided us with a matched set of instruments by perhaps the most sought-after living luthier alive, named Sam Zygmuntowicz, who happens to be my neighbor in Brooklyn. we have a set, two violins, a viola, and a cello, all made by Zygmuntowicz. And so we have this wonderful, kind of 16-string instruments sound, because these instruments all came from the same source. So they resonate together in this gorgeous way. So we're so fortunate to have that.
Fantastic. And I want to take a quick break, Richard, and then I want to introduce Caitlin, and I want to introduce Jed Kim when we get back from the break. And by the way, dear listener, we're going in and out of this whole interview with music by the Aeolus String Quartet. The reason I'm speaking with the quartet is I'm super excited they're coming to Santa Barbara on the 17th. So if you're listening to this program now, it's, you know, you don't have much time. It's this Monday is coming up, the performance. So you want to go online to the Santa Barbara Museum of Art and get your tickets now. And Rich, let's go to quick break. And, you know, we, like I said, take a listen. This is music by the quartet that we'll be hearing.
And you're clear.
I guess so. So Richard,
yes, Elizabeth.
Yeah, can we hear the music?
Yes, I was playing the music down the line to you.
I'm not hearing it.
Well, you're not hearing it now. We're in a commercial break right now.
Oh, okay.
I'll play the music when we come back.
Okay.
We just played that, the Walker, which is what you played the end of just now. We played that last night.
How was it received?
Really well. It's a really amazing. George Walker is this really kind of unsung composer. He's the first Black composer to win the Pulitzer Prize in America. And that piece is called Lyric for Strings. It's a really, really beautiful slow movement that we've played a lot in the past couple of years.
Yeah, sure.
I didn't know about your doctor. If you ever need problems like falling asleep, I'd read it to you.
I bet Steve would be so interested. Actually, he would be so
interested. He's a finance guy, right?
Maybe that's how you can like get him back for the doctor.
Can you guys get ever so closer with the mic? Just a little bit closer. Here we go.
Stand by in 3, 2, 1, you're live.
Welcome back. It's Elizabeth Stewart, and I'm speaking with the members of the Aeolus String Quartet. They're coming to the Santa Barbara Museum of Art on the 17th of October, which is Monday. So don't wait. Get your tickets now. And we were introducing the quartet. We spoke to Nicholas and we spoke to Rachel. Caitlin is here. And Caitlin is speaking to us from her family home in Oregon. I noticed the sort of knotty pine paneling. And I said, I guess you guys aren't in a hotel. They're doing a West Coast tour. And I find out that Caitlin was celebrated on stage last night for her work at Project Chamber Music. And that is so cool. And we read a little bit about Project Chamber Music, where Caitlin's actually brought chamber music to places that you would not think of. And the weird thing is this totally fits with her bio, because as we're finding out, she's a Grammy Award recipient. And she's performed across the globe in collaboration with artists such as Ishtar Perlman and Radiohead's Johnny Greenwood. So obviously she has a wide-ranging understanding of music in general. Recitalist across five continents, Carnegie Hall, Sydney Opera House, United Nations. She's appeared with members of the Tokyo, Cleveland, Juilliard, Guarneri String Quartets. She's passionate about collaboration, as we know, with other art forms. She also performs with Mark Morris Dance Group and Wendy Whelan. And she is has performed with Bjork. And she's actually appeared on film. This is Darren Aronofsky's mother. Okay, so Caitlin, I got to ask about that.
Oh, I was part of the group that provided the soundtrack for that film.
I didn't know that.
Okay, so you didn't perform a role in the film. You actually provided.
Thankfully for all involved, I was not involved in the acting side. just playing my viola.
And you have an interesting viola as well. English luthier William Forrester's viola. Tell me about that.
Yes, well, I'm very fortunate. I play on two violas. As Rachel was saying, we are so indebted to the Five Partners Foundation for providing the group with a set of Zygmuntowicz instruments. So I play on a Samuel Zygmuntowicz viola that actually was made in 2020. So she's brand new, and it's been really, really fun to hear how that viola has changed my experience in the quartet. As Rachel was saying, it's such an incredible thing to hear the way that the sound of these four matching instruments comes together. And I say that with a lot of love for my other viola, which is William Forrester, as you said. It's an 18th century English viola.
So before we went on the air, Richard, I asked the quartet how they're traveling, and they're flying from their concert venue to concert venue. Mm-hmm. And now we learn that they have these incredibly valuable instruments. Yeah, you know where I'm going with that. So
I do. I just have one question about the viola that she's talking about. Does he know you have his viola?
He does now.
He does now. You are being followed now. Yeah. Go ahead, Elizabeth.
Okay. Yeah. So how do you take care of your instruments flying? I mean, you know, with the going through the metal detectors and the pat downs and this and that. I mean, what's the protocol?
Yeah, well, we all carry our instruments on the plane. So the viola and the violins can fit up above, and Gio's cello gets its very own seat on the plane.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. Yeah, so never under the plane.
But okay, I think yes.
More challenging than being in the airplane itself sometimes are the climate changes that happen when you're on a tour such as this. Uh-huh. So going, you know, from the East Coast climate and level of humidity to Oregon to then California, sometimes those changes are the most difficult thing for the instruments.
And so what happens? What does climate do? What does you say it's difficult, but what actually occurs?
Well, yeah, I mean, you can...
Our instruments are made of wood, and they're incredibly sensitive to especially humidity changes. So like if it gets dry, my violin feels, it doesn't ring as much, and it's harder to like activate the sound. If it gets wet, then too humid, then it feels like you're playing inside of a pillow or something. So it changes the response of the strings and the sound that you hear, but it's very sensitive.
So where is the ideal place to play?
It's different for every instrument. There's some that really more moisture in the air, and some that really respond better to dry. I mean, it's cool. It always makes me think of, sorry, this is getting very nerdy, like Harry Potter, like wands and stuff, you know, like it's like, it's about matching the instrument to the person, and each instrument has like slightly different attributes. And that's really a magical thing, because like the instruments are alive too in their own way.
Well, you realize, you do realize that when it gets really, really wet and humid, human beings have the same problem, you know, sounding like we're coming from a pillow.
Yeah,
that's
true.
Yeah. I'm curious how you overcome that, though. I mean, if you're in a place where it is overly damp and the humidity is up 60, 70, 80%, what have you, how do you overcome that when you know you've got to perform? You can't throw them in the dryer.
Actually, one of the places that immediately comes to mind is a place that Gia has a really strong connection to, the Perlman Music Program. It's like Perlman's festival in Long Island, which the quartet attended a long time ago. But they have concerts in a tent outside. And I remember that feeling like I was literally inside of like a wet blanket playing. Because it's in the middle of the summer in Long Island. And you can't really, I don't know, there wasn't much to do. You just have to deal with it. But it does, like, once you play there or in a situation like that and you can deal and you find out, oh, I can get through this, then every other place feels fine. Like, you're not as worried about. It's almost more about how you respond to it. Like, if you freak out and start trying to adjust everything and play, then you're going to sound worse. If you just play like you normally play, usually it's better.
And I wanted to introduce to you Kim. She's the cellist in the group. And, you know, Nicholas was just referencing her mentorship and with famous Ishtar Perlman. She writes in her bio that she's grateful to her mentors and teachers, Ishtar and Toby Perlman, et cetera, et cetera. And she studied with incredible greats at the Juilliard School for a bachelor and master's degree in music. And so, would you tell us a little bit what's working with Ishtok like?
Well, they're the reason why I'm a musician today. I was sort of going through a period where I wasn't sure if I want to pursue music. And I attended the program they created, his wife created actually, for young artists from ages 12 to 18. And the program is inspired by this idea of a non-competitive, supportive environment for very talented string players from all over the world. And because their background, both of them, was from a very intense violin background, they want to create a place where it's not competitive and everybody's equal. And I attended that program by luck and it changed my life. It changed my life because I found my lifelong friends there and I felt for the first time that I could be in music. And I didn't want to live a life without music after I attended that place. And then the Perlman sort of naturally became my mentors after that. So I've been very closely involved with them since 2003. He is what you see on TV, what you see on the concert stage. He's exactly that personality, that generous, humorous, and just incredibly inspiring as a violinist and musician on and off stage. He's exactly that. And that's what I think a lot of people that come into contact with him appreciate about him. He makes wherever he enters, that room becomes better because of him. Yeah. And he has that kind of power in every area of his life. So I feel that, you know, I call them my mentors because they're my musical heroes, but also personally too, you know, how they are with their families, how they treat their colleagues. It's all very much the same. Yeah.
I just want to mention before we go to break that Gia Kim is on the faculty at Juilliard School Pre-College Division, the Perlman Music Program, the New York Youth Symphony Chamber Music Program, Artistic Director of the Central Chamber Series in New York City, and Spruce Peak Chamber Music Society in Stowe, Vermont. And, you know, the list goes on. She was visiting artist at the University of Hawaii, American Academy of Jordan, the College of William and Mary, Grand Valley State University. And I want to ask when we get back from the break about this particular position she had. She served as tone judge. for the 2016 Violin Society of America's International Competition. I want to know what a tone judge is when we get back from the break.
You're still the tone judge.
Yeah, Richard, let's go to a quick break, and then we're going to learn a little bit about what a tone judge does. I can't wait. Don't turn that down. Back in a minute. This is the Aeolus String Quartet.
That was pretty. And you're clear.
We actually recorded that.
Yeah, we sure did.
10:31. Okay. We end at 10:31. Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
There were tones.
Waiting.
It on the highway going on fire.
Really cute.
Passing it on. Was that underneath?
It was slid underneath.
Oh my gosh, seriously?
That's so nice. We probably have, well, we could ask how much time there is.
Get some more
coffee. Sure.
Yeah. I think we're about to take her somewhere.
In 3, 2, 1, you're live.
Welcome back. I'm speaking with the Aeolus String Quartet. Nicholas Tamini is here. Rachel Shapiro, Caitlin Lynch, and Jia Kim is talking with us about their experience as members of the quartet. And I asked you, and before the break, she was a tone judge for the Violin Society of America's 2016 International Competition. And I wanted to know what a tone judge does.
So there's a competition that's held for new instrument makers. So violin makers, viola makers, cello makers from all over the world sent their instruments to this one convention. And that year it was held in Cleveland, Ohio. And we gathered at a hotel, I think, a huge conference room where I had to play maybe 60 to 70 cellos. And so how it works is they choose three artists. So it was me and two cellists from the Cleveland Orchestra for that year. And in separate rooms, we played all of the cellos that were there. And basically we're using the same bow so that we can figure out how this cello sounds. So there are some that were automatically eliminated because it wasn't playable, because some had to travel a long time and they didn't have time to really make it to a proper condition that was playable. So, you know, some of them we kind of went through very quickly, but then the next day we gathered with a pool of maybe 10 cellos that we all liked that had the best scores. And what we did was we took those 10 cellos and we played for each other. So what we're listening for is you know, how does it feel to play this cello? Is it comfortable? Does it have nice balance between the strings? And we're also judging for the tone, which which I think is somewhat ambiguous, but it's basically how it feels for us to play. We're trying to see if it projects. We're trying to see if it has flexibility. We're trying to see the range of soft and loud, tender and powerful, and we're trying to sort of gauge the range of the cello in every area. And I think playing for each other, sometimes we found that it may feel different. Some cellos had a really nice, you know, easy kind of response, but then it wasn't projecting. So it was really good to have the colleagues' feedback. So we did maybe 3 days full of just playing different cellos. And then by the end of the week, we choose a winner, a first, second, and third place. And it then, you know, the first place of these conventions, these competitions, they get to, you know, use it as part of their bio. And it's really, I think most of the new makers that a lot of our colleagues play on, they've entered this competition, VSA, and they scored pretty highly on them. So,
you know, I never knew that even existed. That's fantastic. You know, and now I'm going to tell you some stories about Richard Dugan, who's friend and producer here.
There we go.
And his musical experiences. And I want your reaction to a couple of these stories, you four. So Joshua Bell came and performed here, and we had the opportunity to have him. It was pre-COVID, so we had him in the studio. And he brought his violin and he was playing something live in the studio. And Richard asked him, you know, I think he mentioned to you before we went on the air, Richard mentioned, you know, why don't you change if you've got a symphony you're playing, you know, and you feel like playing it in another key, why don't you change the key? and his, you can only imagine his response. It was very interesting. But he said something to the effect that, and I never forgot it, but he said something to the effect, you know, I don't know if you know this, you guys, but, you know, I'm an appraiser of fine art for 30 years. So I look at works of art. And he didn't know that, but he said, you know, what's so interesting is if you go into a museum and you see a Picasso and there's, you know, in the composition and there's yellow, for example, you wouldn't go and change that yellow. It would be a different thing. And so Richard said, so, but what does that exactly mean? And he said, you know, what's so interesting is that every work has a different emotional register. And so, you know, if you're playing in one particular key, it has a different register and it feels different. So you normally would not change that. And then Richard asked the same question when Maestro Dudamel came to perform here. He asked the same question. I know Richard's laughing, but he said, you know, Maestro, I mean, you got the whole orchestra in front of you. Why don't you change the key? I mean, pop something fun on them, change the key. And, you know, what was so interesting was Richard comes from the background of, you know, turntables and, you know, 40, 50 years in radio. And of course, he can slow down or speed up, you know, as he wants. So to him, that was just a really obvious question. You know, why don't you take it a half step lower? I can. The orchestra should be able to, you know.
Yeah.
Well, Richard, you're laughing, but you
I
did.
Know, but I did. I'm not saying I didn't. I did ask those questions. That is true.
So I would like to know, you guys, what would your response be if Richard asked you that question? You know, why don't you play in another key? Why don't you just say, okay, tonight, gang, or Nicholas tells you tonight, gang, the Mendelssohn is going to be a half step lower.
Oh, gosh. Well, for one thing, it would sound really bad because it's really hard to do that on the fly on string instruments. Yeah, I think I would agree with both of them, with Joshua Bell and Maestro Dudamel, that each key kind of has its own identity, emotional and musical identity. Beethoven believed that he wrote letters to a friend, like impassionately defending like that different keys had different meanings almost. And he's kind of famous for certain, like he wrote a lot of pieces in C minor, like his famous Fifth Symphony. There's a string quartet in C minor, Opus 18, number 4. And it does have like all, and it's interesting. I don't know if it's a chicken or an egg problem, but like all of those pieces have this very dark kind of furrowed brow, intense quality that I think Beethoven at least felt like was intrinsic to C minor. And it wouldn't be the same if it was in B minor, for example. Mm.
Fascinating. And then when we get back from the break, I'm going to tell you Richard Dugan's story about the mighty Wurlitzer theater organ that we have. That's a great story, but we have that at the at one of our, you know, ancient but revered theaters here.
Oh yes,
the Arlington. So you know, Richard had a magnificent performer of the theater organ come to Santa Barbara, and we had him on the program. And Richard had a very interesting question for him. So I'll tell you that question when we get back from the break. Great. I want to reintroduce, I have the great honor and pleasure of speaking with the Aeolus String Quartet. They're coming to our museum, Santa Barbara Museum of Art, on October 17th, which is Monday. So if you're listening to me now, time to get your tickets, go online to the Santa Barbara Museum of Art, and you know, have a wonderful, wonderful evening Monday night. Richard, let's go to quick break. And also, the music we're going in and out of all of the segments are music by the Aeolus String Quartet. Don't turn that dial, back in a minute.
And you are clear.
How long is this break, Richard?
2 minutes. So whatever you got to do, you got 2 minutes.
Thank you.
If you got them.
Yeah. Upstairs.
We'll be caffeinated for the remainder.
And now you can ask us all the questions about them.
Yeah.
Well, and of course, I have a question for the tunist, if you will. I don't remember the exact name of the position.
Concertmaster.
Oh, well,
and they're testing all of these instruments that are made out of a material that can be adversely affected by all kinds of environmental conditions. Isn't the assessment somewhat subjective?
Oh yeah, you're asking, like, this is for Gia, right? Like,
yeah, exactly.
Oh yeah, it's totally subjective. And that's why, I mean, in a way that's a good thing, because like if there was one objective, like, oh, that's it, that's the best tone, then like music would be over, you know, there would be no, but there, it's more, I would say it's more like there are like an infinity of different types of beautiful tone, and each violin or viola or cello is kind of like an individual voice that has its own, it's not that I do think, you know, you could probably say, like, for example, like a student violin that you start on is not as beautiful as like Josh Bell's Stradivarius. That's pretty easy to say, but then when you get up, when you have like two different beautiful instruments, they're just two different people, two different voices. So it's kind of, yeah, then it becomes subjective.
All right, we are going to be coming back here in just a moment with another one of those fascinating stories that Elizabeth has about yours truly in 3, 2, 1, you're live.
Welcome back. It's Elizabeth Stewart. I'm speaking with the Aeolus String Quartet. based in New York City. They're on currently on a West Coast tour, coming to Santa Barbara on Monday, the October the 17th, to the Santa Barbara Museum of Art. And that's super exciting news. I was telling stories of Richard Dugan, our producer, and his relationship to sound and music. And he had some really insightful questions to the various luminaries and performers that we've had come through Santa Barbara. And, you know, you guys, you four, Richard's background is that, you know, he's been in radio for 40, 50 years, but he was also born legally blind. And so he relied on his oral capacity. And so basically, you know, he's very close to sound in general. And in fact, my buddy Richard can do any accent, any voice, any timbre, any pitch, you know, and does a lot of voiceovers for musical theater and on online performances, et cetera. So really closely related, you know, that ability to hear. Anyway, so my story I was promising you about the Wurlitzer Theater organ that we have at the Arlington. It dates back to the 20s, and it's a super interesting. When you think about it, it's not just one instrument. There is a keyboard, but all through the walls of the Arlington, if you get a chance when you're here, you should ask for a tour. All through the walls of the Arlington are various other musical instruments that instrument is like the main sort of synthesizer computer that play. But it's all based on mechanical. It's not anything digital. It's all, you know, the drums are behind one wall, and here's, you know, the pipes are there, and all these instruments are connected. They're like 20 some instruments connected with this organ. And it was gutted from the theater back in the 60s. And then a bunch of really interesting engineers that were interested in sound, and the translation between mechanical to digital, bunch of old guys. They took it upon themselves to find the organ and to find all the various pieces of the organ. They found the main organ in Texas and had it brought back here. And they, over the years, have been restoring the mighty Wurlitzer. So we were celebrating the Wurlitzer. We had a performer come and was on the air with us. And Richard asked him the following question. So you've played theater organ, you know, professional theater organ player usually is to silent movies, you know, where you have the kind of thing. And Richard said, could you wreck the theater?
Oh,
whoa. Which was a really interesting question because, you know, Richard, in his experience with radio, can play pitches and amplify pitches that can destroy walls. And he asked the theater organist, can you bring down the theater? And he said, I thought the guy was going to really, you know, get insulted and slug Richard and this sort of thing, because he was also in the studio. But he said, actually, I had something like that happen.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I was playing the theater organ. There was a resonant frequency that shook the apartment building next door.
Oh, interesting.
Wow. Yes. And he said we had to stop the performance. It was that, because, you know, you can get such a massive sound from some of these pipes are so large in the theater organ. You get this massive, massive sound. And Nicholas, I can see you. You're a dear listener. You're listening to us on the radio, but Nicholas is nodding his head. I want to throw that question to you because of your physics background, Nicholas.
Yeah.
Can you explain that to Richard?
No, you're absolutely right. Well, at first when you said, can you wreck the theater, I thought you meant like, can you play so badly that everyone
That's another aspect of it, but
it's
not
certainly possible. no, it's really, I remember attending a concert at Royal Albert Hall in London, which is this huge hall where they have the Proms concerts, and they have one of the biggest organs in the world in that hall. And I remember like learning that, yeah, some of the lowest notes on the organ, they can only play for a certain amount of time because it hits the resonant frequency of the building and like parts of the ceiling will start to fall off.
Wow.
Because the pipe is, I don't know, probably like 2 feet wide. Like you're dealing with giant. Yeah, I mean, so that's a real thing. Resonant frequency, every material that's regular has a frequency that if you if you have an oscillator in it, it'll amplify that. And if you keep going, it'll amplify it until the material breaks. The most famous example of that is the Narrows Bridge in Tacoma, Washington, where actually my wife is from. Thankfully, this happened way before she was born. But if you go, there's video online of Galloping Gertie. It was a huge suspension bridge across the Puget Sound, and they built it too thin. And one day, the wind coming down the sound, which is pretty narrow at that point, hit the resonant frequency of the bridge, and it started like undulating like a string on an instrument. And then the bridge like collapsed. It was terrifying. Thankfully, I don't think anyone died because they got off the bridge in time, but it's kind of, so yeah, that can totally happen with organs. You gotta be careful.
By the way, the organ that we've got here at the Arlington gives, I think, true definition to the word one man band or one woman band, because you can make so many incredible different sounds from it. It's amazing. And then the theater. I was introduced to an acoustician who worked on the Granada, which is just up the street. Even the Arlington has its own acoustics. And I would think maybe you could minimize that kind of an effect by changing the acoustics in the room, in the auditorium. But I mean, I think that would be a monumental effort in that regard, and probably very, very expensive too.
You know, and you guys should know, when you get here to Santa Barbara, we were a second Los Angeles back in the talkie days, in the pre talkie days. Mm-hmm. So in the silent film days, you know, we were another location for films that went all over the world. What was so interesting about Santa Barbara is there's so many different geographic locations where you can do desert, or you can do tropical, or you can do ocean, or you can do mountains, or you could do early Greece, or a Western. And so people would come here because they could actually pick and choose. And so our theater, where the silent films were performed back in the teens and the 20s, the Arlington, was really famous for that. And we were talking with this theater organist who was saying, you know, I just am so honored to play here because we can mimic what that event was like in 1915. And so Richard had some recordings of things that he had performed, and Richard's absolutely right. Some of the tricks that organ can do, you would have sworn that there was a train coming through the studio. Remember, mm-hmm. Richard?
Oh,
he
yeah,
did this
yeah.
This chunk, 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 chunk. And, it, you know, it sounded so much like a train that was all done on this organ. Okay, Richard's giving us a sign that we got to go to quick break. And Richard, I'm going to save the last couple of questions for you. I want to see if I can catch another wonderful tidbit that I can...
All right.
My memory. Yeah, don't turn that down. Back with the Aeolus String Quartet coming to the coming to the Santa Barbara Museum of Art this Monday, October 17th. Get your tickets now. Go online to Santa Barbara Museum of Art and you'll find them there. Don't turn that down. Back in a minute.
All right, you're clear.
I'm down for going to catch it for so long.
Yeah, I think I have.
Yes, yeah,
scary.
Yeah,
it's
crazy.
Terrifying. Yeah, that's so scary. How is nobody on it?
Well, there were people on it, but it took a while. Yeah, it like started, you know, when a bridge starts going like this, you're like, oh, I should get it off. And it's the it was in the 40s, but like there happened to be some guy, like I think a news reporter or something with a camera. So like
that's wow. Video.
Well, there he just happened to be there. And he was able to
yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yes.
No, no, but I thought you were going to use the money and something else. Oh.
So that's what we'll do.
So, you know,
the you guys, I grew up, I was telling you about my mom who was a conductor, and she still does. She has perfect pitch. And that was a pain in the ass. it really was, because, you know, she was so sensitive. Well, you guys are so much younger, but we used to have these alarm clocks that you wound up. You know, and as the it
okay,
rang.
Okay, we are coming back. You've got four minutes.
Can only
three,
imagine.
Two, one, you're live.
Yeah.
Welcome back. It's Elizabeth Stewart. I'm speaking with the Aeolus String Quartet coming to the Santa Barbara Museum of Art October 17th. I promise Richard, on the hopes that he'll say something that I can put in my memory bank. yeah, Richard, the questions are yours.
All right. Well, I we'll go back to the aspect of the instrument itself. It has always fascinated me, the invention of the diversity of instruments that we have, specifically in this case, for classical music, whether it be a brass or wind or string or percussion. What is the, I've understood that the, for example, the bow is usually made, the bow portion that touches the strings is usually made of horsehair. Now, that's still being done today. And then the strings, what were they originally made of when these instruments were first came into on the scene, if you will? I'm sure now they're probably made out of metal of some sort. Do you know any of the history behind the instruments you play?
Yes, so it's all part of our training to enjoy the weird little facts of history for our instruments, because like the strings, the actual, and people who do historical performance today still string their instruments with gut, like cat gut, right? Initially,
meow.
Yeah, I know, right? This is a very controversial thing, and yet it's. The strings they're very sensitive and very delicate. They break super easily, but I think the most pure kind of historical performance involves unwound gut. And then there are different, sometimes it's wound gut, so that would be a gut core wound with metal around the outside, and sometimes a combination of the two. And some modern instruments still have these strings with gut cores, but as you said, Richard, there are also synthetic alternatives. I mean, they all have a whole like different universes of sound depending on what you choose to use on your instruments.
Well, and of course that raises the question that you were talking about earlier in terms of, you know, tuning these instruments or toning them, if you will, or listening to them and seeing if they fit. And I made the comment during the break that, well, this whole thing's got to be very subjective, because in addition to sometimes you have no control over the environment, every person in that group that is working on listening to these instruments has a different hearing capacity, aptitude, if you will, you know, if an audiologist came in and tested. So I guess real quickly in the last minute or so, How do you circumnavigate that whole aspect of the variable?
A lot of arguing.
I'm kidding.
Also. Well, Richard, I have to say that as it, you know, an avid lover of classical and new music, it's intangible. So that's the thing about great art, is it's almost, you know, it's beyond itself. So it's intangible. I mean, it's a great question, but the answer is well, if we knew the answer, we wouldn't be crying when we listened to Mahler. Right? Well, listen, I got to give another shout out. The performance is Monday, October 17th, the Aeolus String Quartet. And I thank you guys, Nicholas and Caitlin and Rachel and
Hi,
Gia.
I'm Chris Cullen.
I'm Lisa Cullen.
Sorry about
that. There we go.
We were very close there, but you're clear. I'll go ahead and put in a little bit of that announcement in there from the previous one of the previous segments.
Sounds good. Thank you, guys. That was really good.
Hey, guys, would you mind taking a picture with us so we can give a shout out to your station on our social channels?
Okay, so Richard, will you do that?
What do you want me to do now?
Oh, yeah. Okay, you guys can do it. Sure.
Yeah, you guys go ahead, for sure.
I think it's like control, command, click or something.
One,
like
MacBook Air. Four.
Four? Control, command, four? Nothing's happening.
Okay. Oh, you're working off of an Apple. Oh, I'm so sorry.
Shift, command, three. Okay, everybody.